I want to finish up the study that we started yesterday on pride and self-esteem. And just to recap a couple of the points that I made yesterday, I think I thoroughly established that pride is sinful. There's no such thing as good pride or a good being proud. That is non-existent in the Bible. We also looked at the fact that God hates pride. So most of us hate it too in other people. We don't always hate it in ourselves so much until we realize that it's there. But everybody realizes what a distasteful thing pride is, and God feels no differently about it. And then I left off talking about how a realistic self-esteem, a realistic estimation of yourself is not sinful. Because if you think about it, a realistic estimation of yourself is the truth. Right? I mean, if it's a realistic estimation, so just to simply state the truth is not pride. It can't be. How could it be pride? But now what I want to show is what a realistic opinion of ourselves should be. So it's one thing to say that a realistic opinion of ourselves is not pride. That's true. But now we need to learn what a realistic opinion actually is. So the first thing that we need to realize about a realistic opinion of ourselves is that in us dwells no good thing. And this is just, I'm going to give you some points just on some good old-fashioned total depravity here and just remind you of what you really are. And it's not going to make you feel very good, but it should make you feel good when you realize that you're not like that anymore, and it's because of what God did and not because of what you did. If you look in Romans chapter 7 and verse 18, here's the Apostle Paul. No slouch, mind you. He wasn't just, you know, some they that profess that there's God but deny him in works type of guy or something. Paul was a good and godly Christian man. And he says in verse 18 of Romans 7, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For the will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not." So Paul wasn't one of these guys that thought, well, yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of bad stuff in me, but, you know, I guess if we look at it in balance, I'm probably more good than bad. Paul says, no, no good thing. In my flesh, no good thing is in me, Paul said. These next few points I'm going to go through, because I do have a lot of information here, and I do want to try to keep this to a reasonable level, a reasonable length. And we've been through many of these verses before, so I'm just going to go through these bullet points. I'm going to quote the verse roughly about as best I can and just hit these rather quickly because you are familiar with them. But the fact is about us that we were conceived and born in sin. David said that I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin doth my mother, or did my mother conceive me, in Psalm 51 and verse 5. Psalm 58:3 says that the wicked go astray as soon as they be born, speaking lies. So it starts off with conception. As soon as a baby's born, he comes out speaking lies, the Bible says. And then furthermore, I don't even have this one in the outline, but then in Genesis, God says that man's imagination is evil from his youth. So we got conception, we got birth, we got youth, and of course then throughout adulthood. And the reason for this is because we all inherited this sinful nature from Adam. Romans 5:12, "For as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so that death passed upon all men." So we inherit this thing. We get it by nature, in fact. In Ephesians 2:1-3, Paul says that we're dead in trespasses and sins, that you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. So this is something that is in our very nature. Just like when a dog's born and he's born a dog and not a cat or a snake, well, we're born sinners. That's just who we are, and there's no changing that. It says in Isaiah 64 and verse 6 that we are all as an unclean thing, and our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. So not just our bad works are bad, but our good works are bad because they're all tainted by sin. We're unrighteous. Paul tells us in Romans 3 and verse 10, that there is none righteous, no, not one. Jesus said in Mark 10 and verse 18, that there is none good but God. We're not good. We're not righteous. And we don't do any good. We can't do any good. Romans 3:12, there is none that doeth good, no, not one. This is what you are by nature. So if you want a realistic estimation of yourself, well, when you're looking at yourself, apart from what God has done for you, this is your realistic realistic estimation of yourself. So you really can't have too low of a self-esteem when it comes to looking at what your flesh is and what your nature is. Think about the worst thing you can possibly think of, and you're worse than that. There's nothing to do with good. Paul said in Romans 7 and verse 8 that sin wrought all manner of concupiscence in him. Concupiscence is evil desire. And he says, all manner. There is nothing, nothing that you could not do. You think about the worst, most heinous sin imaginable, and it is possible for you to do it if God just lets you to your own natural devices. Sin wrought all manner of concupiscence in Paul. Paul said in Romans 7:24, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? We are wretched men. We are evil. Jesus says in Matthew 7 and verse 11, if ye then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more so your Father which is in heaven. He calls his own disciples evil. And it's true, we are evil by nature. We're hateful in Titus 3 and verse 3. Paul says, I will read this one because I don't have all these memorized. Titus 3 and verse 3. He says, for we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. So by nature we are hateful. It's not a learned trait, it's just what we inherit by nature. And you just take a little kid and just don't train him and don't teach him to share and that kind of thing. And he's going to get mad at his siblings or his friends. He's going to hit them. He's going to jerk toys away from them. He's hateful by nature. That's just the way we are. It's not flattering, but it's true. It says in Titus 1:16, Paul says that the reprobate is abominable unto every good work. Titus 1:16, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work, reprobate. Abominable means, as I said yesterday, a feeling of combined disgust and hatred. That's what we deserve, that feeling of God. We deserve that by nature. In James 4 and verse 5, it says that the spirit in us lusteth to envy. That is the nature of our spirit. We are prone to lust, to envy. We want what we don't have. We hate other people because they have things that we don't have. That is what envy is. That's what we are. And we are full of all manner of wickedness, which we will act out if God turns us over to that reprobate mind. And I will read this one. This is the last of this sordid description of ourselves. In Romans chapter 1, 28 through 32, if you think you're a good person, let me show you what you would be if God just lifts up his hand and takes off the restraints for a little bit. Romans 1, 28 through 32, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. That list right there is what you and what I would be doing if God would just pull back the hands of restraint and just let us live out our corrupt, sinful human nature. So that is an accurate description of your flesh. That is, if you esteemed yourself like this, you would have a proper self-esteem. But thankfully, that's not the end of the story. That might be the case with all natural men out there whom God has not changed, but that's not the end of the story with us. Thankfully, God has saved us from this depraved nature and condition by his mercy and his grace. He saved us when we were without strength to do it ourselves. Look at Romans 5 and verse 6. Romans 5 and verse 6. It says, "For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly." And of course, we were without strength. Without strength, not physical strength, but without strength to change our condition. Because when you look at the things that I just listed off there and what the Scripture says about us, of course we're without strength. What could a person in that shape, what could they possibly do to change their nature? There's nothing they could do. Of course we're without strength. God had to do it all for us. Look at Romans, look at verse 10 of chapter 5. "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life." When God saved us, it wasn't due to anything that we did. We weren't the ones that made the peace. We were the enemies. God is the one that made the peace. Now, this is important. I know you've heard sermons on grace many, many times, but it's important for this study too, because if you understand that you are a wicked sinner by nature, and that the only reason you're any different from that is because of what God did by Himself, which had nothing to do with you, how could you be proud about that? How could you possibly boast about something that you are whenever what you were was just a rotten piece of trash and God changed you and made you what you are now? There's no boasting about something like that. When God saved us, we were dead in trespasses and in sins. This is the verse that I quoted earlier. But I'm going to read you the couple of verses after that, and we're going to see that it was God that made all the difference. Ephesians 2, 1 through 5. It says, "And you hath He quickened," which means to make alive. That's when we were born again or regenerated. "And you hath He quickened who were dead in trespasses and in sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others." But like I said, that's not the end of the story. Look at the next verse, and it starts out with "but," contrasting conjunction. "But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved." When you were dead, when you were by nature a child of wrath, when you were walking according to the prince of the power of the air, that's when God in His grace and mercy saved you. He gave you eternal life by giving you to Jesus Christ and having Him die for your sins and take your punishment upon Himself. Now the thing is, we had nothing to do with this. 2 Timothy 1:9, it says, I'll get it as soon as I look at the first word. 2 Timothy 1, verse 9, I've quoted this verse so many times, and that if you just can't get the first verse, or the first word, then you may as well forget it. Who hath saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. We were not saved by our works. What does that mean? It means that there is no boasting. Because if you were saved by your own works, then you could boast about it. Hey, I did a good thing, and I improved my spiritual condition, and hey, you know, if it wasn't for me, this wouldn't have happened. You could boast about it, right? But there is no boasting, because it's not according to works. It's according to His own purpose and grace. Titus 3:5 says, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost." Not by works of righteousness. And of course, one of my favorite verses in Romans 9:16, Paul says, "So then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy." It wasn't your will or your works, but it was God's mercy. Now, because, like I just said, because we were saved by grace and not our will or works, we cannot take pride in our salvation. And sometimes people want to accuse us of that because we believe in sovereign grace and we believe that we are elect, that we have been chosen. And people say, "Oh, you believe you've been chosen. You're just so special, aren't you?" No, they don't understand the whole concept. We're not special. We are nothing but worthless, wretched sinners, and God chose us due to nothing that we did. If they understood the doctrine of election, they would never say, oh, you think you're so special, you think you're chosen or something. Well, maybe I am special in God's sight, but it's not because of something inherent in me that he chose me. He didn't choose me because of any of that. He chose me because he wanted to choose me. No different than a baby at an adoption agency could tell all of his friends someday, hey, I'm really special, I'm chosen. You know, your parents just kind of got whatever they got, but my parents chose me. Well, it wasn't because of anything you did. They just looked at you and said, I want that one. I mean, you can't take any responsibility for a parent choosing you, choosing to adopt you, and neither can we take responsibility for God choosing to adopt us. So since we have nothing to do with it, we certainly can't boast or glory about it. In Ephesians 2, 8 through 9, this is a verse that most people that profess to be Christians know. Unfortunately, I wish that they actually knew whose faith was under consideration. They understood what it was teaching, but they know the verse anyway. They just don't understand the proper interpretation. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, it says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We're not saved by works. We're saved by grace through the faith of Christ. You see, it says, therefore, by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. Now, most people say, well, it's the grace that's not of yourself. Well, why does it say we're saved by grace through faith, and that not of yourself? The grace through faith, the whole thing, is not of yourself. Well, whose faith is it? Well, if you have a King James Bible, it's Jesus Christ's faith. Paul said, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. We are justified by Jesus' faith. It's not of ourselves, and therefore, because it's not of ourselves, and it's not of works, we can't boast. If it was of works, we could boast. On Judgment Day, I could be standing over here on his right hand being a sheep and looking over here at this guy on the left hand being a goat and saying, hey, you know, boy, you really blew it. I mean, all I had to do was just humble myself and do some repentance or whatever, pray some prayer. I did these things, whatever. And look where I am. I'm on the right hand. You're on the left, buddy. If you would have just done what I did, you'd be over here on the right hand. Sorry for you. That's not how it works. If you're on the right hand, it is not because of anything you did. Furthermore, you wouldn't even think to say something like that because you're on the right hand. You understand why you're on the right hand. Look in 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 7. Paul taught that if you receive something by a gift, why would you boast about that? 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 7 says, for who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory, as if thou hadst not received it? Paul says, what do you have, spiritually speaking, that you didn't receive, that God just didn't freely give you? You don't have anything. So how could you glory about something that you received? And I use the example of being tall or being pretty or whatever, you know, having really nice hair or something like that, or an ability to speak or an ability to run really fast or whatever. Why would you glory about something like that whenever you didn't do anything? You just received it. In this case, you received it through genetics or DNA or from God himself. You received a gift. You can't glory about something that you've been given that you did nothing to receive. It'd be like some foolish person that gets a large inheritance and then glories about how rich they are. Well, you have no business glorying. It's not like you didn't work for it. That's fine. You can have it, but you shouldn't brag or glory about it. You didn't do anything to get it. Now, if you worked for it, you'd at least have some claim to glory over it. But that's the whole point about salvation. You didn't work for it, so you can't glory about it. And the thing is, anything that we are is because of the grace of God. We are what we are because of God's grace. In 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 10, Paul recognized this, and Paul was the cream of the crop when it came to not only to Judaism, but to Christianity. Whatever he did with all his might. And in verse 10, though, he gives all the glory where it is due to God. He says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. I think this is probably this verse encompasses all of what I'm telling you in these two sermons, I think. And I just kind of noticed that right now. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Paul recognizes that I am nothing. I'm a wretched man. But what I am right now is by God's grace. It's by what God has done. So Paul recognizes that I am nothing, and whatever I am now is because of God's grace. But then look what he says. So there's God's grace, but then look at Paul's responsibility to do with what God has given him what he ought to do. He says, "And his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all." So Paul was given, abilities to write, to preach, to do the work of the ministry. And once he was given those abilities, he did not let those things be given to him in vain or uselessly, but he put them to work to the best of his ability. He says, "I labored more abundantly than they all." Now, is Paul boasting and saying, "I worked harder than they all"? No, he is stating a fact. He is stating a fact that he worked more abundantly than all the rest of the apostles. There's nothing wrong with stating a fact. But then look what he says. But he doesn't state the fact and says, "I worked more abundantly than they all because I'm just such a good guy. I'm just so much better than them." Look at what he says then after that. "Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me." It's God's grace. I work and do the best I can with what God's given me. And I work hard and I recognize that I have labored hard and that I have done something here. But then I look back and I say, "But yet not I, but the grace of God which was in me." Even the hard work and the more abundant labor that I did was by the grace of God which is in me. Paul was not glorying in his own works. He was glorying in the grace of God. So how should we properly esteem ourselves then? Well, number one, we should recognize that our human nature is capable of doing any evil. Anything. Like I said, there is nothing. Sin wrought all manner of concupiscence in Paul. There's nothing that we couldn't do. So you always want to remember that. Just whenever you are thinking about yourself, just remember, always remember what you are and that you could do anything that anybody else has done. You read about horrible things that people have done and you think, "Oh, that's just terrible. How could somebody do that?" But just remember, "But by the grace of God, there go I." Any one of us could do that. We should recognize that we have no responsibility for our salvation, nor for our faith, or for our works that are the fruits of it. Remember there in Ephesians 2, 4 through 5, "But God, who's rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you're saved." So we got no responsibility for our salvation, nor for the faith that we have. John taught us that whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory which overcometh the world, even our faith. John is saying there that our faith is born of God, and it overcomes the world, because it's given but to us by God. That's in 1 John 5 and verse 4. "Nor are our good works of ourselves." The good works that we do, God created us in Christ Jesus to do these good works, which he had before ordained that we should walk in them. That's in Ephesians 2 and verse 10. It says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." So we can't glory in our salvation, we can't glory in our faith, and we can't glory in the good works that we do. We can't glory in any of that stuff because it was all given to us of God. And whatever we do is done by the grace of God, like Paul says. So yeah, we actually do the works. We're not just hands on a or gloves in a hand or something like that. We do the good works, but we do them by the grace that was given unto us. We don't do them of our own power or volition. We should not look at ourselves as worthless sinners, but rather as sinners who have been saved by God. See, I want to steer between two extremes. Because there's one extreme that would look at the verses that we just read in the beginning and say, "I'm just worthless. I'm nothing. I am of no value to God or to man or to anybody. And I may as well just kill myself because there's nothing good in me." Remember, that wasn't the end of the story, though. We don't want to look at ourselves merely as worthless sinners, but as worthless sinners saved by grace. Look at 1 Timothy 1 and verse 15. 1 Timothy 1 and verse 15. And when you do that, you won't be proud because you know that by nature you're a worthless sinner. But then you also won't be so despondent and just worthless in the world because you realize, I'm not just a worthless sinner, though. I'm a worthless sinner saved by God, and now I can do the good works which He has given me to do. So that helps you to steer between both wrong paths of either pride or a feeling of utter futility, one of the two. 1 Timothy 1 and verse 15. It says, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Paul recognized that he was a sinner saved by grace. And if God saved Paul, He can save any of us, because Paul says he was the chief of sinners. I've heard people say, well, he thought he was chief, but he never met me. Well, you know, if he said he's chief, maybe that was his own opinion, I don't know, but I'm not going to try to say I'm chiefer than Paul. You know, I'm not going to boast with Paul contend with Paul about who's the worst of the sinners. But anyway, the Lord knows that we're both pretty bad, and I'll just let Him figure that out, who's worse. So here's how we should esteem ourselves. We should know and accept that by God's grace, we are the following things. Number one, we are chosen by God. There's no pride in saying that I'm chosen by God. You're just simply believing what the Scripture says about you. Ephesians 1 and verse 4, it says, according as He hath chosen us in Christ, or in Him, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. So we're chosen by God. We are predestinated by God to be His children. In the next verse, in verse 5, it says, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will. So we're chosen in Christ. We are predestinated to be the children of God. That's who we are. And we can say those things without pride. Now, you could say them with pride if you think that there's something special about you, that's why God chose you. But if you properly understand what the Bible teaches about election, you can say that without pride. And that can give you a lot of comfort and make you realize, I'm not just a worthless piece of trash. I'm a worthless piece of trash that God has transformed into something useful. That's what I am, because He's predestinated me to be His child. We are the sons of God. Look in 1 John 3, 1 through 2. 1 John 3, 1 through 2. It says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew Him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. We don't even know really what we are. We know that we're the sons of God, but it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Someday Jesus is going to come back, and He's going to change not only this sinful spirit that's already been changed, He's going to change the sinful body, and He's going to give us a new body, fashioned like unto His glorious body. And we don't really know exactly what we're going to be, but we're going to be like Him, we know that. So remember that about yourself. You are a child of God, a son of God, and a daughter of God. You are loved by God. Look at Revelation 1 and verse 5. This is how we properly esteem ourselves. We're loved by God. Revelation 1 and verse 5. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto Him that loved us and washed us from our sins in His own blood. We're loved of God. We're justified of God. By God. Look at Romans 3 and verse 24. Romans 3 and verse 24. It says, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. We're loved, we're justified, we're sanctified by God. Look at 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 11. 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 11. Paul here is writing to these Corinthians who were all manner of sinners before they were saved by the grace of God. And we're talking really bad things like fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, effeminate, abusers of themselves with mankind, which are sodomites, thieves, covetous, drunkards, revilers, extortioners. These are the types of people that the saints in Corinth were. But then Paul says in verse 11, and such were some of you. See, words are important. Thank God for the past tense there. Such were some of you, not such are some of you. But such were some of you. But ye are washed. Ye are justified. But ye are sanctified. But ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So we are sanctified. Sanctified means set apart to be holy. We are holy vessels to God. We're cherished by God, which is sort of like loved, but cherishing is more than just love. It's to make much of somebody. Look in Ephesians 5 and verse 29. That's why husbands are supposed to cherish their wives, make much of them, make them feel special and important. That's how we are to God. The same way that a husband should feel about his wife is the way that God does feel about every one of you. He makes much of you. He's happy whenever you are in his presence. He enjoys being with us. Ephesians 5 and verse 29. It says, for no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. The Lord cherishes his church. He loves it. We're the apple of his eye. Actually, that's one of my next verses. That is my next verse. So funny how I say that. Didn't even look down at the outline. I guess it's because I made the outline. Maybe that's why I'm thinking like the outline. I don't know. But anyway, Deuteronomy 32, 9 through 10. Deuteronomy 32, 9 through 10. It says, for the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. See, this is speaking of the nation of Israel back then. But what do we know about Israel? Israel was a picture of God's elect, were they not? And plus, Israel were the church. You know, they were called the church in the wilderness. So this is God's church that he's talking about here. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land, that was in Egypt, and in the waste, howling wilderness. He led him about and instructed him. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. The apple of his eye, I don't really know where that phrase or that term came from, but we all know what it means. The apple of somebody's eye is like that one really important thing in their life that they just cherish more than anything else. That's how we are in God's sight, the apple of his eye. And lastly, we are complete in Christ. Look in Colossians 2 and verse 10. A lot of people live their whole life really without purpose. They just don't feel like they've really found themselves. They don't, you know, people go to college, they say, to find themselves or something like that. And a lot of times, most times, people don't find themselves in college. They lose themselves in college and they lose their faith. Even in Christian colleges, it's no worse or no better. Actually, a lot of times it's worse. These kids go to Christian colleges and they don't find themselves. They certainly don't find the Lord. They lose themselves. They lose their own souls, and they lose their faith in God. And I know what I'm talking about. I have a cousin that went to Moody Bible, or a cousin-in-law, went to Moody Bible College as a somewhat Bible-believing Christian, grew up as a pastor's kid, goes to Moody, learns this postmodernism garbage there in Moody, and takes a very liberal interpretation of the Bible and ends up not really believing it's the Word of God, and now he's a full-blown atheist. And he's dragged my little cousin along with him, so she's an atheist too. That's what happens when you send your kids to these Christian colleges. Don't even waste your time with Christian colleges, in my humble opinion. If you want to do that, go ahead, but you are risking losing your children by sending them to a depraved institution like that in a lot of cases. So, we're chosen by God, we're predestinated to be the children of God, we're the sons of God, the daughters of God, we're loved by God, justified by God, sanctified by God, cherished by God, we're the apple of God's eye, and we are complete in Christ. Oh, I was sort of, that's where I was going with that, going to college to get to know yourself or find yourself. You don't need to go to college to find yourself. Look in this book. You want to find yourself? This book will tell you what you are by nature. It'll let you know what a sinner you are, and it'll let you know that you're a sinner saved by grace. And it'll let you know how to live and how to please God. And whenever you live and keep God's commandments and do things that are well-pleasing to Him, you have found yourself. You have found the purpose that God has made you for. Because we're told in Ecclesiastes that let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter, fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. You want to find yourself? Do what this book says, and you'll have found your purpose in this life. And the thing is, in Christ we are complete. Did I even read the verse? I don't even think I read the verse. Colossians 2 and verse 10. I got sidetracked. It says, "And ye are complete in Him, which is the head of all principality and power." So therein lies our completeness, in Christ. It's what Christ has done for us and what Christ has made us. There is our completeness. It's not in a spouse or in children or in friendships or in families or in anything else. It is in Christ. Now, the nice thing is Christ provides all those other things to make us a full person. So in Christ, He provides the spouse, He provides the family, He provides the church, He provides all those things to make us a complete person. Therefore, we should never esteem ourselves to be worthless. How can a person who reads this, a Christian that reads this Bible and believes it, and believes that he is chosen, predestinated, a son of God, loved by God, justified by God, sanctified by God, cherished by God, the apple of God's eye and complete in Christ, how can a person look at himself, knowing those things about himself, and say, "I am worthless. I am of no value to anybody, including God"? That's ridiculous, isn't it? How could you possibly say you're worthless? You are obviously a very valuable person in God's sight, because He sent His own Son to die for you. That's how valuable God views His elect, because He would send His own Son, His own self in the flesh, to die for those people. John 3:16, we all know this verse. John 3:16, here's how much God loves you. Here's how much you know that God loves you. Because He sent Jesus Christ to die for your sins. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's how we know how much God loves us, because Christ died for us. And another John 3:16, this is 1 John 3:16, tells us how we know, how can we know the love of God? Here's how we can know the love of God. 1 John 3:16, "Hereby perceive we the love of God, because He laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren." We don't perceive God's love in our circumstances. If you guys back there in the back row would have perceived God's love by your circumstances in the last year, you would have probably concluded, "God doesn't love me, or He would not have put me through this," if that's all that you were thinking about. But that's not how we perceive the love of God. We perceive the love of God because Christ laid down His life for us. That's how we know that God loves us. To esteem ourselves to be worthless is to insult God who made us. I mean, how could you look God in the face and say, "I am completely worthless in Thy sight"? You're not. You're not. In your flesh, in your nature, you are. But in your new man, you are not. You are absolutely not. We must never believe anyone who tells us that we are worthless. Any child out there, I wish there was every kid in the world that has been mistreated and told by his parents or told by somebody else that he's worthless. And I wish I could tell him, "You are not worthless." Don't believe anybody that tells you that you are worthless, because you're not. You're valuable. And you're valuable because of what God has done for you. If we esteem ourselves to be chosen, predestinated, loved, justified, sanctified, cherished, children of God, then in a sense, we have a high self-esteem, don't we? You think about it. I mean, that is a high self-esteem. If you value yourself, loved, predestinated, cherished, saved, justified, you have a high self-esteem. And that's a good way to have a high self-esteem. This high self-esteem, this is a biblical and a healthy high self-esteem. Because it's not a high self-esteem that's motivated by pride. Because we realize, we already know, we learned, what, a half an hour ago, what we really are, and we know why we are what we are now. It's not a pride high self-esteem. It's a biblical high self-esteem. This high self-esteem is esteeming ourselves as God sees us because of what God has done for us, not what we have made ourselves. Now, on the other side, though, a biblical high self-esteem is good, but we must always be humble, because we know all these things. We know we're saved by grace, and we know what we are. We're rotten sinners, but then we still have this spirit in us that lusteth against this flesh in us that lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit in us lusteth to envy, and we still have a tendency to become proud, and we must always remember to be humble. 1 Peter 5 and verse 6. 1 Peter 5 and verse 6. It says, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. In due time, that means it might take a while. It's not going to come immediately. But the Lord tells us, if we humble ourselves, which means having a low estimate of one's importance, worthiness, or merits, marked by the absence of self-assertion or self-exaltation, lowly, the opposite of proud. So if we have a low estimation of ourselves in our flesh, then the Lord will exalt us in due time. You see, because of our fallen nature, we do have a tendency to become proud. And I read that verse to you yesterday in Mark 7, 21 through 22, where Jesus says, out of the heart proceeds all these things, evil thoughts and adulteries and things. And one of those things was pride. That's what comes out of this fleshly heart that we have. We must always remind ourselves of what we were before God saved us, which is what we would be had he not. Always remember that. I'm just going to read that sentence to you again. We must always remind ourselves of what we were before God saved us, which is what we would be had he not. The first 10, 20 minutes of the sermon of what we were before God saved us, that's what we would be had God not intervened. We don't ever want to forget that. We must not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think, but we should think of ourselves soberly. Look at Romans chapter 12 and verse 3. Romans chapter 12 and verse 3. Paul says, for I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, if you look at just contained in that verse, you see there that it wouldn't be wrong to have an accurate self-esteem, because he says not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. He doesn't say that no man should ever think a good thought about himself or a true thought about himself. He doesn't say that, but not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think, but to think soberly. Soberly is gravely, seriously, quietly, without any sign of excitement, impatience, or other strong feeling. So in other words, we should think about ourselves seriously, gravely. We should not think about ourselves in these flowery terms or these grandiose ideas, these self-deceptions of ourselves, but think about ourselves seriously. Look at what the Bible says about us and then give an honest examination of your own life. And if you'll do that, you're going to have a rather low opinion of yourself, because you just see that flesh that's always trying to bring you down. And that's good, to have a low opinion of yourself and to realize what you are. That is a good thing. But not to have this so low opinion of yourself where you feel utterly worthless and futile and of no value to anybody. That's a different story. We must esteem ourselves more highly. We must esteem others more highly than ourselves. I almost said esteem ourselves more highly than others. That's totally backwards from what I've been trying to say all morning. Philippians 2 and verse 3. We must esteem others more highly than ourselves. This is hard to do because, remember, the spirit within us lusteth to envy. We have a tendency to be proud. We have a tendency to think a lot of ourselves. And if we think a lot of ourselves, we're going to have to think less of other people. Because if we think highly, more highly than other people, then that's going to bring down our own self-image. And most of us don't like to do that because it goes against our nature. But in Philippians 2 and verse 3, it says, "Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves." You see how pride leads to strife? You notice what Paul says there? Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. When people esteem others better than themselves, there's not strife or vainglory. But when we esteem ourselves more highly than others, then there becomes strife. Because we start to get into strife with people. I mean, if I esteem myself more highly, I have better ideas than you do. And you have an idea, and I have an idea, and these come into conflict, and I'm going to fight about this because I'm clearly right, because I'm a better person than you are. That's where strife comes in. And I'll give you a verse that just flat out says that in just a minute. Only by strife cometh contention. Now, esteeming ourselves, not esteeming ourselves more highly than we ought to think, but thinking soberly, and esteeming others more highly than ourselves, this is a biblical definition of low self-esteem. You think about it. If you esteem others more highly than yourself, that means you esteem yourself lower than them. Therefore, you have, by biblical definition, a low self-esteem, or at least a lower self-esteem. And that is a good, healthy, low self-esteem. To esteem ourselves as sinners by nature, as lower than others, and not more highly than we ought to, is a good form of low self-esteem. But to esteem ourselves to be worthless is an unbiblical and an unhealthy low self-esteem. So there's two different kinds of low self-esteem. There's a biblical low self-esteem, where we view ourselves the way that God views us, or the way that we should in light of what we are. We're sinners, but we're sinners saved by grace. But we look at other people more highly than ourselves. That's a good low self-esteem. But then there's the other low self-esteem where I'm worthless, I can't do anything right, I may as well just go shoot myself because I am of no value to anybody else. Nobody loves me, everybody hates me. That's not a good low self-esteem. Now here's one that'll blow your mind. And you might think this is wrong until I explain it out to you. One can have an unbiblical and an unhealthy low self-esteem and yet be proud. So you can have a low self-esteem and yet be proud. You think, well, these things seem to be mutually exclusive. How can you have a low opinion of yourself and a high opinion of yourself at the same time? Well, let me show you. This person can be stripped of all self-worth and feel that he's good for nothing, and yet strive with people who are trying to help him understand that he does have worth in the eyes of God. So here you can have a guy that feels like he has no self-worth at all. But yet when somebody tries to help him out and show him, you actually do have worth. You actually are not what you think you are, because look at what the Bible says about you and look at what God has done for you. And the person argues or contends with them and says, no, I really am just worthless. They're contending. They're striving. And what is the cause of contention and strife? It's pride. It's pride. Look at Proverbs 13 and verse 10. Proverbs 13 and verse 10. It's kind of weird. It's weird to get your mind wrapped around this, but I'm convinced it's true. People with a quote low self-esteem, as the world defines it, actually have a pride issue. Seems weird, but I believe it is the case. Proverbs 13 and verse 10. It says, "Only by pride cometh contention, but with the well-advised is wisdom." Now here's the word of God telling us that if there's contention, it only came from one source, and that's pride. So if you have a person with a, quote, low self-esteem and somebody tries to help them out, whether it's to help them have a higher self-esteem or just help them out to do something or to learn a better way of doing something or be more productive or whatever, and they contend and argue with that person and they don't want help from that person, there's a pride issue there. Only by pride cometh contention. Look at Proverbs 28 and verse 25. Proverbs 28 and verse 25. He that is of a proud heart stirreth up strife, but he that putteth his trust in the Lord shall be made fat. You see, it's the man of the proud heart that stirs up strife. If we could just, as a church, if we could just get rid of our pride, we wouldn't have any church problems anymore, because only by pride cometh contention. And you can bet every time that you find contention between two people, it'll be an interesting exercise. You husbands and wives, I know none of you ever have contention between you, but because you're Christians. But if you ever happen to, for some strange reason, just look at the contention and figure out, okay, whose pride was it? Of course, it's always going to be her. You know, it's going to be the other person's pride, no doubt. But it's going to be somebody's pride anyway. And I'll bet you more than likely, there's probably two people that have a pride issue there. More than likely. It's pretty hard to contend with a person that's just a humble person and, you know, just kind of happy-go-lucky, right? So more than likely, there's two people that have a pride issue there. This person with the low self-esteem is too proud to admit that he has a problem and that somebody else has the solution. If somebody truly had a low self-esteem, they would be happy for somebody else to come in and help them out. If they truly esteemed others better than themselves, they would esteem the person trying to help them out as better than themselves trying to help themselves, and they wouldn't resist the help, right? But the problem is, they actually don't have that low of a self-esteem. They actually do have a pride issue, and they don't want help from somebody else. They view that other person as lower than themselves, because otherwise you would accept the help, right? If I wanted to become a better public speaker, and if Dale Carnegie was still alive today, and I went to Dale Carnegie, or Dale Carnegie came to me and said, hey, you know, if you did this, this, and this, you'd be a better public speaker, and I just despised the guy for it, well, obviously, I'm not esteeming him very highly like I should, right? I'm thinking that I know better than he does. That's the problem. Look at Philippians 2 and verse 3 again. Philippians 2 and verse 3. I mean, you could be a guy, I'll just use myself as an example. You could be a preacher, and maybe you do have some issue where you feel like, I'm not a good preacher. I preach terrible sermons, and other men are better than me. But then if one of those other men would come to you and try to correct you on something, and then all of a sudden you swell up with pride and you don't want to hear it, you don't really think that you're not that great of a preacher. You really actually think you must be better than this guy, or you would listen to what he has to say. You think about that. Philippians 2 and verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. So I'll say it again, if you truly esteem the other better than yourself and you truly had a low self-esteem, then you would accept the help. But if you contend with a person that tries to help you get out of your problem of having a low self-esteem, you actually have a pride issue. You know, this is also manifested, and this is the thought that I had yesterday when I was staring in the mirror putting my contacts in. Strange time when you have an epiphany, but this is the thought that I had then also. It's also manifested in the person who dresses or acts or talks in a way that is self-demeaning or self-hating. You know, because we've all met, especially teenagers probably, that get into this, you know, gothic type of clothing and they act strangely and they rebel against authority. And we look at some of those people and say they have a low self-esteem. Well, it may be in a sense they do, but they have a pride issue. They have a pride issue because they may appear to have a low opinion of themselves, but actually they think too highly of themselves and are acting out to get the attention that they think they deserve. They think they deserve more attention. They think that they ought to be recognized by people, and they're not recognized by people. So they go the low self-esteem route of wearing the black clothing, putting on the weird makeup, gouging out their ears, tattooing their face all up or whatever. They do all that, and we say they have a low self-esteem. No, actually they don't. They have a pride issue because they think themselves more highly than they ought to. They think they ought to be getting the attention that they are not getting, and they do those things to get the attention. I think that's the truth. I do believe that's the truth. Now, if such a person in this condition will humble himself and admit that he has an unbiblical and an unhealthy, quote, low self-esteem, then God will lift him up and give him a proper understanding of his own worth. So the person that has the low self-esteem needs to admit that they have a pride issue, and then God will lift them up. That's the key to them getting out of their low self-esteem, is admitting their own pride and admitting that they need help, humbling themselves. Look at James 4, verse 6 and verse 10. James 4, 6 and 10. That's why I'm really concerned when I see Christian kids dressing strangely and all that kind of stuff. I had people that I know, I'll just be very vague, but people that I know that are close to me that are not in any of the churches that we know, but extended family members. And I saw Christian kids in those families and their friends dressing like very worldly, acting very worldly. And it was just a real concern to me. I just thought something's just not right here. Christian kids shouldn't be acting like that. They shouldn't be dressing in such a way to try to attract attention to themselves. There's something going on there. And I hope that my kids never do that, and if they do, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to have to figure out what the problem is, because there's obviously some problem. Your kids start dressing up like weirdos, there's a problem, and you better try to get that straightened out. Look at James 4, 6 and 10. It says, "But he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble." You want to be helped? You got to admit that you got pride first. You got to humble yourself, and then God will give you grace. God will lift you up. Verse 10, "Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up." It so goes against the very nature ingrained within us. I can do it myself. I don't need help. And the person that doesn't need help doesn't, or thinks they don't need help, doesn't get the help that they really need. But if they'll humble themselves and admit that they do need help, then God lifts you up. But he wants to break you first. He's got to break you of the pride. You've got to admit that you're proud first. The next thing that we should understand to have an accurate self-esteem is that we should understand that God has given us talents and abilities that we have. So we do have. Some of us, all of us, have different talents and abilities, and some of us clearly have better abilities in certain areas than other people. And that's okay. That's the way that God's made us. And it's okay to acknowledge and admit those things. That's all right. But you just want to be careful and not become proud of them, because that's easy to do. We're told in Romans 12 and verse 3 that God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Romans 12 and verse 3. "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Every person God gives the measure of faith to. Some have more faith than others. Why is that? It's because God gave them more faith. So we never want to glory in something that was given to us. Remember that. God has given each of us differing gifts. Look at Romans 12 and verse 6, just a few verses later. He says, "Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given unto us," see, the gifts come by grace, you didn't work to earn them, "whether prophesying, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness." Whatever your gift is that you've been given, exercise it according to how the Bible says you ought to exercise it. Use it to benefit your fellow brethren. But we never want to glory over that. Some people are given one talent, some are given five, some are given 10. The Lord gives out the talents as he sees, or as he is pleased to do so. you look in Matthew 25, 14 through 15. Matthew 25, 14 through 15. I've made reference to this parable here, seems like a few times as of late. Matthew 25, 14 through 15. We remember the parable here of the kingdom of heaven. It says a man traveling into a far country, he called his servants and he delivered them his goods. And in verse 15 there, it says, and unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Now this is a parable of the kingdom of heaven, of a man going into a far country and delivering servants' talents. It's not a great stretch to figure out what's going on here. Jesus Christ is the man that traveled to a far country and he gives gifts unto his servants. And when he returns, he wants to see those talents used to the best of our ability. But what I want to draw your attention to is just the basic fact that he gave one guy 1 talent, one guy 2 talents, and one guy 5 talents. Now, the guy that has the 5 talents ought not to look at the guy with the 1 talent and said, I was given 5 times more than you. Obviously, God knew there was something special about me that, you know, you didn't have, clearly. That would be wrong, wouldn't it? The guy with the 5 talents should just say, God gave me 5 talents. He just did. I don't know why he gave me 5 talents, but he gave me 5 talents. I'm going to use those 5 talents the best I can. The guy with the 1 talent shouldn't look at the guy with the 5 talents and say, well, why'd God give him 5 talents? I should have had 5 or at least 2. Why did he only give me 1? Just do the best you can with the talent that God has given you. That's all we have to do. That's what God expects us to do. He expects us to do whatever we can do to the best of our ability. Look at Ecclesiastes 9 and verse 10. Ecclesiastes 9 and verse 10. Doesn't matter if we have 1 talent, 2 talents, or 5 talents. Do the best you can with what you have. Ecclesiastes 9:10, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. So you take that talent and you do it with all thy might. You put that talent to the best use that you can. Now, if we do the best that we can with what God has given us, he will be pleased with us. Look at Matthew 25, 23, or 20 through 23. And this is just such an encouraging parable to me. Such an encouraging parable. Because the neat thing is that God doesn't expect the same amount of output out of all Christians. He expects the same proportional output. So he expects you to take whatever you've been given and do the best you can with what you've been given, but he doesn't expect the same thing. Because if he expected the same thing out of all of us, the same level of everything, I mean, we'd all be just wasted away in futility, because there's going to be some people that have more talents than others, and we're going to look at that person and we're going to feel insecure. We're going to feel worthless, like we are not measuring up. But that's not what God expects. God just expects us to do the best we can with what he's given us. Some people have circumstances where they just can't do what other people can do. Some people have circumstances where they can't be at Bible study every time like other people can, or whatever. And you know what? You just do the best you can with what you have. God doesn't give the same exact circumstances and lifestyle or whatever. That's not really the word I was looking for. But anyway, he doesn't give you the same circumstances as everybody else. So you just do what you can. You do the best you can. And he's just as happy with the person that does what they can with what they have than he is with the person that has full freedom to do everything they wish they could do. He's just as happy with both people. Matthew 25, 20 through 23. It says, and so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. The Lord gives him a nice commendation there, doesn't he? This guy took the 5 talents, he made 5 more, and the Lord is very pleased with him. But look what happens to the guy with the 2 talents. Verse 22, he also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, not too bad, but you know what? The other guy made 5 talents. You know, you keep working at it. You're not really measuring up to the other guy. That's not what he said. The Lord said, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. And I know I'm probably a broken record because I've preached on this several times, but I just can't help myself. I love the fact that the guy with the 5 talents that made 5 talents did 100%. He got the same exact commendation as the guy with the 2 talents that made 2 talents and made 100%. Same exact wording to both of those guys. God was every bit as much pleased with the guy with the 2 talents as he was with the guy with the 5 talents. He was just as pleased. It's all about the proportion. It's not about the absolute output. It's about the proportion. And every one of you with kids would feel the same way. I mean, let's face it. One of your kids may have an IQ. Go back to my example. Maybe one of your kids have an IQ of 130 and one of them have an IQ of 90 or something. It doesn't matter how hard your son with an IQ of 90 studies, he will not be able to do as good academically as the kid with 130 IQ. Period. It doesn't matter. I don't care how hard he works. I don't care how hard he tries. He will not. He is physically incapable of doing the same level of output. But that doesn't mean he's less valuable of a person. It just means that maybe just like he wasn't given as big of muscles as his brother, he might not be given as big of an intellect as his brother, but it doesn't matter one bit. It doesn't say anything about the person's character or about their worth in the eyes of God or about their worth as a child to you. It doesn't matter. You just do the best you can with what you have. Now, you want to be careful with that because sometimes it's hard to distinguish between the kid, and this is just what I've read from like James Dobson and things, but it's hard to distinguish between the kid that has the IQ of 110 and the kid that has the IQ of 90, because sometimes the kid that has the IQ of 110 works like he's got the IQ of 90. He's just lazy. So if you got to figure out which is the lazy kid and which is the kid that just doesn't quite have the, you know, the ability, and then make sure that you hold the one that does have the ability, hold his feet to the fire, but don't try to hold the feet to the fire of the one that just doesn't have the ability and can't do it. You're just going to discourage him, you're going to demoralize him, and it's going to be guaranteed that he's going to have a life of disappointment because he's always going to feel like he never measures up, and it's not his fault. He just doesn't have the apparatus upstairs, and that's just fine. Now, acknowledging that we have gifts and talents given to us of God is not pride. And I got Bible for this. Just simply acknowledging it, saying God has given me a gift to do thus and so, is not pride. I'll just use myself as an example. God has given me a gift to be a pastor, to be a minister. It's not pride to say that God's given me the gift. If I say that I don't think God has given me the gift, then what the heck am I doing here? You know, I better go do something else if I don't even believe that God's given me the gift. I have to believe that God's given me the gift. But that doesn't mean that I should be proud and say, well, it's only because I was such a great Christian that God gave me that gift. That's got nothing to do with it. It's just the fact that God chose to give me the gift. Look at Ephesians 3 and verse 7. Ephesians 3 and verse 7, Paul here recognized where he got his ability to do the work of the ministry. Ephesians 3 and verse 7, Paul says, wherefore I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Paul freely admitted and gave all the credit to God. I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of God's power. Not by my own intellect or my studying or my ability or my dedication, none of that stuff, but Paul was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto him. And there was nothing proud about that statement, about acknowledging the fact that God had given him the gift of the ministry. Look at 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 5. Now, like I said, the difference between acknowledging the fact that you have something and glorying in it is very, very small. It just takes, you can just flip over from acknowledging a gift to glorying in it in a very short amount of time. So we all have to be careful about that. 2 Corinthians 11 in verse 5. Paul says, "For I suppose that I was not a whit behind the very chiefest apostles." I don't think Paul was being braggadocious there. I don't think he was being proud. I think Paul was just simply stating a fact. "I suppose I was not a whit." I wasn't even a little bit behind the chiefest of the apostles. Paul says, "I was right up there with the best of them." He's just acknowledging a fact. He already said in another place that "I am what I am by the grace of God" in the first letter he wrote to the Corinthians. In the second letter, he says, "You know what? I don't think I'm behind any of them. I'm right up there with them." But he's not bragging about it. He's not proud. He's just simply stating a fact. But we must never think that we are superior to someone else because of the gifts and talents that we have, or that we don't have, or that they don't have. Look at verse 8 of Philippians 3 in Ephesians 3 in verse 8. That's what I was trying to say. You're thinking, I'm not sure about that gift of the ministry thing that you keep talking about here as you bumble along through verses. And Ephesians 3 and verse 8, Paul says, this is right after he got done saying that God made him a minister by his grace. "Unto me," now look at, here's Paul's attitude. Is Paul bragging and boasting about the fact that God gave him the gift of the ministry? Absolutely not. "Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ." See, Paul held an office which was basically the highest office in the Christian church. He was an apostle. That was the chief office. And not only was he was an apostle to the Gentiles. Peter was an apostle to the Jews, one nation. Paul is an apostle to all nations. This man was the greatest Christian that ever lived. And he says, "Unto me who am less than the least of all saints is this grace given." And in another place, he explains why he says that he was the least of all saints. Because he persecuted the church. Look in 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 11. 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 11. This isn't the verse that I was thinking of, but anyway, there's another place where he says, because he persecuted the church. He says, "I am become a fool in glorying. You have compelled me, for I ought to have been commended of you. For in nothing am I behind the very chiefest apostles, though I be nothing." I'm not behind them at all. I'm right up there with them, but I'm still nothing. And what's that mean? The rest of them are nothing either. We're all nothing. We would be nothing except for the grace of God. But neither should we think that we are inferior as a person to someone else because they have gifts and talents that we don't have. We shouldn't think that we're superior because of the gifts that we have. Neither should we think that we are inferior because of the gifts that they have that we don't have. There's no room for any of that stuff. Now, whereas acknowledging the gifts that we're given, acknowledging the talents and abilities that we have is not pride, boasting about our merits and thinking that we're important because of them is pride, and it is sinful. There's a big difference between acknowledging and boasting. Now, some people have figured this out pretty well, and they can boast by sounding like they're acknowledging. You know, some people are pretty clever about how they go about, my brother calls it a backdoor brag. And that's, you know, some people have figured that one out pretty well too. Like, for instance, I went to my grandmother's funeral, and I didn't really hear much of this there, but this happens all the time. You go to a funeral, and the latest thing is at the funeral where everybody stands up and gets the mic and is able to say something, anybody that wants to, which I personally don't care for, but hey, if you like that kind of thing, whatever. But what it a lot of times ends up being is not talking about so much the person, but talking about the person, but in a roundabout way, as my brother says, a backdoor brag, bragging about you and how close you were to that person or whatever. And I didn't even take the mic. And as you know, I was very close to my grandma. I didn't even take the microphone. I didn't say anything. I didn't even feel like I needed to say anything. I knew how close I was to my grandma. I knew what memories and what great times that I had with her. And I didn't need to get up there and tell people about them. That wasn't necessary at all. And I was thankful that not many people did that, because I just find that so distasteful when, you know, or people end up making amends, like they kind of want to try to set the record straight if they had some kind of a problem with that person in a roundabout way in their remembering them, you know. So anyway, I don't like any of that kind of stuff. But boasting is sinful. It's pride. Look at Romans 1 and verse 30. Or what happens is you get somebody up there, you give them the mic, and they don't know when to shut up. That's a very dangerous thing in a public place. Hand somebody a microphone, because some people just don't have the wisdom and discretion to be holding onto a microphone. I saw it like a Donald Trump rally one time, and he gave the microphone over to some woman, and I thought, you are crazy. And she starts talking, and then I saw it with another guy. He starts talking and talking and talking, and Trump finally had enough sense to say, thanks a lot, or whatever, you know, kind of like interrupt, but boy, that's a day. Don't give people a microphone that haven't prepared some comments or something, because, boy, they just start getting diarrhea at the mouth, and who knows what will come out. But Romans 1 and verse 30, it says, these are the list of the sins that God gives people over to. Backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. So right there, proud and boasters go hand in hand. The two of those things are bedfellows. We must learn to let others praise us and not praise ourselves. This is one of my favorite verses in Proverbs 27 and verse 2. I didn't say I mastered it, I just said it's one of my favorite verses. Proverbs 27 and verse 2. It says, let another man praise thee, and not thine own mouth, a stranger, and not thine own lips. Like I said yesterday, if your work is truly meritorious, don't worry about it. Other people will talk about it. They will tell other people about it. I mean, do you think that people on YouTube that have millions of views on a video or whatever, you think it's because they have millions of friends that they all forwarded it to and said, hey, you've got to watch this? No. It's because everybody else out there forwarded it to all their friends and said, you got to watch this. That's how, you know, videos go viral. It's not because the guy's promoting himself. It's because... Well, I don't know if I would say YouTube videos are meritorious. A lot of them are just cats doing stupid things or whatever, you know, crazy cat videos. But anyway, you know, they get popular because other people think they're good, not because you're promoting yourself. I love what Charles Spurgeon said. He was talking about this verse in his book, Lectures to My Students. And he said, quoting the verse first, he said, let another man praise thee and not thine own mouth, a stranger not thine own lips, and be very glad when the other has sense enough to hold his tongue. And there's something to that too. Sometimes the best thing you can do is not praise somebody else, because you might end up making them proud. And you know, it's always uncomfortable too. And somebody gives you some comment or whatever, and sometimes, or compliment, I mean, it's just uncomfortable. You know, you never know what to say. I when I was at the Ecclesiastical Law Center, I told the preachers there that I found the best thing to say is just say thank you. You know, don't try to say, oh, well, it wasn't really that great, or blah, blah, blah. Just say thank you. You know, that's something too. You know, everybody, and you want to be humble, and, you know, and we feel like we're proud by saying thank you. You're not proud by saying thank you. Just say thank you and move on. That's what I've found anyway. It works out pretty well. Look at Proverbs 25 and verse 27. And I found after that sermon, then, when I went up to one of the pastors and said, that was a good message, and he smiled and said, thank you. It was kind of funny. Proverbs 25 and verse 27. It is not good to eat much honey, so for men to search their own glory is not glory. If you're searching for your own glory, there's nothing glorious about that. It's only when other people search your own glory is it glorious. And Proverbs 20 and verse 6. Most men will proclaim every man his or everyone his own goodness, but a faithful man, who can find? What does that tell us about a faithful man? He does not proclaim his own goodness. He lets other people proclaim his own goodness. And this is pretty well ubiquitous here. Most men will proclaim everyone his own goodness. The majority of people will do that. You don't have to look far to find a person that's going to tell you how great they are. But a faithful man is hard to find. But this is what a humble person does. The humble person lets another man praise him. He doesn't boast and brag about his own works. Humble, I will remind you, is having a low estimate of one's importance, worthiness, or merits, marked by the absence of self-assertion or self-exaltation, lowly. It is the opposite of proud, the dictionary tells us. And here's a bit of advice. Just let the Lord commend you. You don't need other men to commend you. Let the Lord commend you. Look at 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 18. And for that matter, let the Lord judge you and not let other men judge you. Paul said, it's a very small thing if I'm judged of you. I don't know if it was the Corinthians, I forget what book it was in. Very small thing, he says. I don't even judge myself. It's the Lord that judges me. Well, it's the same thing with commendation. Let the Lord commend you. 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 18 says, for not he that commendeth himself is approved, but whom the Lord commendeth. Commending yourself doesn't get you very far with God, but when God commends you, that'll get you far with God and with men. And John 7 and verse 18, Jesus said that he that speaketh of himself seeks his own glory. John 7 and verse 18, Jesus here is our example. He said, he that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Jesus didn't speak of himself. He spoke of his Father. The Holy Spirit would come and speak of Jesus Christ. Jesus didn't need to promote himself. The Holy Spirit would come and do the promotion for him. Now, being confident that you can do a certain thing if you have that ability is not pride. And I just thought about this one this morning. Actually, as we were driving home yesterday, we were talking about this, and that kind of got me thinking about that. Being confident that you can do a certain thing is not, or have an ability, is not pride. I mean, it's basically just acknowledging the truth about yourself. If you really can do a job, and somebody asks you, can you do this job, it wouldn't even be true for you to say, no, I think I'd probably screw that up. Well, no, not if you can actually do it. If you really have the ability to say, I believe that I can do that and I can do it well. That's not pride. There's nothing proud about that. But boasting about it is pride. See, there's a difference. Acknowledging and boasting. Big difference, and you want to keep those two things separated. And I was just thinking about that. I was just thinking about this morning. Anybody know what LinkedIn is? Anybody heard of LinkedIn? It's a social networking site for people in the business world, basically. And it's sort of like you put your resume on there and you put all your previous places you've been, where you've worked, and a little blurb about yourself. And it's for social networking for business, basically. And it's just it's a bragging blog is all it is. Quite frankly, I hate LinkedIn. I've never been on it. I did sign up for an account so I could look at somebody else's account one time, but I just despise it. And I know it's necessary these days for some people in certain professions. You almost have to be on it. And unfortunately, if you're going to be on it, you almost have to use their stupid lingo. I don't know if you've ever read, just go on somebody's LinkedIn page sometime and read the lingo. They have their own language. Or when you resume language or interview language, it's just all this BS, basically. These great big highfalutin words that nobody would use in normal conversation at all, or in business meetings for that matter. It's all this, if you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. It's just, it's like they have their own language. It's just, I was talking to Jason about this one time, and it's just so ridiculous. He agrees with me. But anyway, even though it's necessary, I still think it's annoying. And the business / CV / resume / interviewing / LinkedIn world is about as fake as soap operas and WWF. It is pure phoniness. It really is. You go on there and you read somebody's LinkedIn page, and you pretty much have to have an interpreter to interpret resume and CV speak to even figure out what the heck this guy is even talking about, because you can make any job sound like the most important, most technical, most, you know, interesting thing ever. And I mean, my goodness, I bet you could post a listing on there if you flip burgers at McDonald's and use all this technical jargon, and only somebody that was really in tune to what you were saying would even realize he's a burger flipper. You know, like, I manufactured, you know, high quality meals, you know, in a automated fashion while doing multiple things and blah, 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 you know, like all this nonsense. He flipped burgers, man, you know? And so anyway, this kind of bragging happens out there all the time. So anyway, that's all I had to say about LinkedIn, but it just, I always hated that. I hated it in resumes. I hated it in interviews. And it's just, it'd be nice to go to an interview and just be straight up casual and just, they tell you what they need. You tell them what you can do and just forget all the flowery BS, you know, and just actually be unlike a normal person and speak in normal language. But it's not the way it works. So we must, getting back to this thing about having others commend you and not commend yourself, we must scrutinize the praise that others give to us. If you look in Proverbs 27 and verse 21, and I know that whole LinkedIn rant was a little bit off the beaten path, but it's just something that sort of irritates me, and it seemed like a pretty good place where I could insert it. It's kind of neat, you know, just thinking about that. When you go to an interview, if you need a job when you're going to an interview, you're all proper schmopper and all this stuff, and you wouldn't dare ask like about compensation on the first interview or anything. But it's a really fun thing if you don't need a job and a headhunter calls you up asking you about a job. And I've been in this situation where you don't care and you're just so nonchalant and you're like, I don't know, what's it pay? But like, you'd never say that in an interview. You'd never act like that. And the thing is, they don't hang up on you. They're like, well, you know, the compensation's this, this, and this. And you're like, well, da, 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 you know, and you're just, it's like they're impressed by the fact that you don't care and you don't seem to be all that worried about it. Now, if you could just psych yourself out to when you actually need a job, to just go in there and pretend like you don't need a job, you'll for sure get a job. But it's just hard to pretend like you don't need a job when you do need one. So anyway, look at Proverbs 27 and verse 20. Proverbs 27 or verse 21, pardon me. It says, as the finding pot for silver and as the furnace for gold, so is a man to his praise. So as the finding pot refines the silver and as the furnace refines the gold, so the man refines the praise. The finding pot and the furnace take the gold and the silver in there and they heat it up. They melt off all the dross. They get rid of all the bad stuff and they keep the good stuff. The man takes in all of his praise, he refines it all out, and he refines out the flattery, the nonsense, which he knows isn't true. He gets rid of all that stuff and pays no attention to it whatsoever, and he takes the sincere and true praise and is thankful to God for it and uses it to learn from or something. So that's what a good man does. He filters out that praise. Don't believe every flattering word that somebody tells you, because sometimes they're setting a net for your feet. It says there somewhere, I don't remember where it is in the Proverbs, that he that flattereth his neighbor spreadeth a net for his feet. So you got to watch out for people that are too praising of you, because they usually have some kind of an ulterior motive. You can tell a lot about a person by how they receive praise. Just watch a guy when he's praised. Look at the expression on his face. Look at, you know, if he's praised and he's just beaming, he's all excited and everything. You can tell some things about people. You just pay attention to that. So we must have a realistic self-esteem. To have too high of self-esteem is not good. To do so is pride, which is sinful and dangerous. Remember that pride goeth before destruction. So we don't want to have too high of a self-esteem. That's for certain. We must not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Romans 12 and verse 3. We should think of ourselves soberly. Remember, that's what Romans 12, 3 said. And I've expanded out the definition and included all the A, B, and C of the primary definition here of soberly. It is gravely, seriously, quietly, without any sign of excitement, impatience, or other strong feeling, in all seriousness, with full conviction, without extravagance or excess. So we ought to think of ourselves seriously and realistically, not extravagantly, not imagining that we're way better than we really are or something like that. Remember, the man that thinketh himself to be something when he is nothing deceiveth himself. We want to think of ourselves soberly, realistically, seriously. Now, on the other hand, to have too low of self-esteem is not good either. To do so says that God did not create anything good and valuable in you as a new creature in Christ. If you view yourself too lowly, that I'm totally worthless, totally fruitless and futile, you are saying that God didn't create a good thing in you. And that is not true. We are new creatures in Christ. We're not that old man. We're not the first 20 minutes of this sermon. That's not who we are anymore. Yeah, we are that way by nature in our flesh, but our new man within us is not like that. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17. It says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. We're no longer that old man. We are a new creature, predestinated, chosen, loved, cherished, justified, sanctified. If our self-esteem is too low, such as having feelings of utter futility or self-hatred, then we will act and speak as if we are totally worthless. Remember, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 23 and verse 7, which is basically what the verse says. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Whatever you think in your heart is what you are. And that will come out. If you think certain ways, you will start to speak those things out. You can pretty much tell what's in a person's heart by what they talk about. And if in your heart you feel worthless, you feel self-hatred, you feel that you are no good for anything and that nobody loves you and God doesn't love you, it's going to come out in your speech and it's going to come out in your actions. I'll give you one more verse. Look at Luke 6 and verse 45. Luke 6 and verse 45. Jesus said, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. And get this, here's the key point. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. The good man has good things in his heart and he speaks good things. The evil man has evil things in his heart and he speaks evil things. Sometimes the evil man tries to speak good things to deceive you, to not think that there's evil in his heart. But eventually it comes out. But the man that has this unbiblical and unhealthy low self-esteem that views himself as nothing but worthless, it's going to come out. And that's not a good thing. Doing so will also hinder our Christian walk and will bring dishonor to our Savior. Imagine that if a Christian feels that they are totally worthless, totally unlovable, totally, they are vain, futile, and they may as well not even be around anymore. What does that speak of their so-called Savior who saved them and who changed them? Well, he didn't do a very good job, did he? So we don't want to have the too low a self-esteem. We don't want to have too high a self-esteem, which is pride. And I hope that I've somewhat sorted these things out for you, and I pray that this sermon will be beneficial to you. Thank you.